So the most important celebration on the Christian calendar every single year is Easter Sunday. And we have decided as a church, as leadership, that we want to offer a 9 o'clock and an 11 o'clock service this coming Easter. We realize that a lot of people travel because that is connected to spring break. And we realize that there's a lot of people that want to travel and they have vacation plans during that week. And so we feel as a church that it is our responsibility to move toward you and where you're at and to give you an opportunity where now you can come to a 9 o'clock service and maybe get on the road a little bit earlier on that Easter Sunday. Our bell choir has decided that they will perform for us twice, which is awesome. That's a big responsibility. And so they are going to perform at the 9 o'clock and the 11 o'clock service. We've also got nursery coverage for the 9 o'clock and the 11 o'clock. And we also have children's church at the 9 o'clock and the 11 o'clock. So we're not worried about space issues or anything like that. We just want to give Christians an opportunity to gather together on the most important day on the Christian calendar to be a part of a worship service. So that's why we're doing that. I want to update you on my situation with my puppy. If you were here if you were here last week, you understand. If you're not, I have a puppy. It chews on everything. I have to put it in a crate. Simple story. Tuesday, though, I was late for my Camden Ministers Council meeting, and I didn't have time to do all the games and things necessary to get my puppy into the crate. And so I figured that I would just be like a ninja and sneak up on Rosie. So she's on the couch, and I'm kind of like creeping up toward her, right? And not making eye contact because I don't want to spook her. And then all of a sudden, I get close enough to the couch, and I leap through the air like Michael Jordan taking off from the free throw line to dunk a basketball, like Spider-Man getting ready to scale a building. I flew through the air. Actually, that's what happened in my brain. Reality is I'm a big boy, and there's a lot of gravity around us. So I missed the dog by like 3 feet. I landed on the couch. The remote goes flying across the floor. I spilled an entire glass of water all over the place. I'm laying there on the ground. I'm just looking at this dog, and I'm like, why did I drive to Pennsylvania to pick you up? Like, you are ruining my life. Get this. That dog looked at me and ran right into her crate. Every day since then, that dog has looked at me, and all I have to do is say, go to your crate, and she goes to her crate. So I don't know which one of you, and I mean one, because probably there was only one of you that prayed for me this week, but I have a list in the bulletin of people I need you to start praying for, because you have a special connection with God, and you need to exercise that gift in a way that brings healing to people that need it, okay? So I'm laying there in the floor, water everywhere. The dog's in the crate. We make eye contact, and it's like she's communicating with me, and she's like, you know, you bathe me, you feed me, you pet me, you play games with me. Like, why wouldn't I want to obey you? You love me. Actually, I'm putting my projection onto the dog. The dog's probably just thinking about milk bones at this time. But I was thinking about that mindset, though, and it's exactly what the heart of this sermon series is. I want you to draw near to Jesus, to understand his love for you, and then to fall in love with his love for you to the point where you look forward to being obedient, where you look forward to doing all the things that God asks you to do, where you trust him implicitly. You don't hear these as commands to keep you from something fun. You hear these as commands that will help you live the abundant life that Christ has for you. And the way we're going to do that is we're going to reflect on the cross of Jesus Christ, specifically a passage of scripture that's entitled St. Matthew's Passion. This is Matthew 26 through 28. St. Matthew's Passion. I also want to give a shout out again to Tim Keller, whose work in this area 23 years ago has really been the catalyst for this sermon series. Let's pray real quick. Father, we are about to read one of the most profound passages of Scripture in the entirety of the Bible. And I pray that you would clear our thoughts and our minds of every single thing that would keep us from encountering you. Lord, you have prepared our hearts through the singing of worship that's just taken place. And so, Lord, now that that runway is prepared, I pray that you would just land your truth into our hearts in a way that would be fresh and new for all of us. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Matthew 26, verse 36. Last week we talked about the Lord's Supper, and so coming out of the Lord's Supper, we're moving into the garden. Then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane. This is an olive garden. And he told the disciples, they didn't have breadsticks, okay, I'm sorry. And he told the disciples, sit here while I go over there and pray. Taking along Peter and two sons of Zebedee, it's James and John, he began to be sorrowful and troubled. He said to them, I am deeply grieved to the point of death. Remain here and stay awake with me. Going a little farther, he fell face down and he prayed, my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me, yet not as I will, but as you will. Then he came to the disciples and he found them sleeping. He asked Peter, so you couldn't stay awake for 1 hour? Stay awake and pray so that you won't enter into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. And again, a second time, he went away and he prayed and he said, my Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done. And he came again, and he found them sleeping because they could not keep their eyes open. After leaving them, he went away again, and he prayed a third time, saying the same thing once more. Then he came to the disciples, and surprise, surprise, he finds them sleeping and resting. And he says, "See, the time is near. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let's go. My betrayer is near." Question is, what's the cause of Jesus' agony? That's the way I learn Scripture. I read it, and then I ask a bunch of questions, and I try to find the answers. And so question number one is, what is the cause of Jesus' agony? So let's back up to verse 36 one more time. It says, "Then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane, and he told the disciples, 'Sit here while I go over there and pray.' And then he took along Peter, James, and John." So he takes Peter, James, and John into the inner parts of this garden, and something astounding happens as they're walking from the exterior of the garden toward the interior of the garden, the place where Jesus wanted to pray. It says in verse 37 that Jesus began to be sorrowful and troubled. B.B. Warfield was commentating on the word troubled. He said the word troubled means horror, a crushing, overwhelming, devastating sense of horror. Verse 38, Jesus says, "I am deeply grieved to the point of death." Warfield again says this grieving is a mental and physical sense of agony that made Jesus feel like he was dying. Something extraordinary, something astounding was happening to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He was walking into the middle of the garden, and something happened to him that made him feel like he was dying a full day ahead of his impending death on the cross. So what is it? What is the cause of Jesus' agony? The Gospel of Mark adds that Jesus was astonished. Jesus, the Son of God, existing fully as a man and fully as God, was astonished. He was astonished at something. He was taken aback. He was caught off guard by something. And then Luke adds that the disciples saw Jesus and saw that he was drenched with sweat and blood. That's a symptom of a very severe shock. So what? What's up with Jesus? What's up with Jesus? Yeah, you're close. What's up with Jesus? All right, so when I was sick, the doctor said, "Well, you know, for the first couple weeks or whatever, just work like half days and then come home." So I was coming home around lunch, and I would just come home and lay on the couch and turn on the TV. And I don't know why, but my YouTube TV was always playing Matlock. I've never watched Matlock. At first, I thought it was extremely cheesy, but it was on every day, and so I eventually kind of got sucked in. I learned to respect this man. I liked his little quips. He was like, "Well, He can't kill anybody." It's terrible, Matlock, I'm sorry. He's like, "Well, he can't," I'm not Andy Griffith. "He can't kill anybody, but he might bore them to death." You know, just little quips like that really brought me in. But I remember watching a full episode. I was like, "You know what, I'm just going to commit to a whole episode." So in this episode, he finds out, because he's like a lawyer and a detective all in one, I guess. And so he finds out that this woman had killed her boss. Problem was, there were 20 minutes left in the episode. And I'm like, what are they going to do for the rest of this episode? He's already solved the case, but Matlock is never satisfied with just the surface answer. He wants to go a little bit deeper because he knows there's something else going on here. And so he actually finds out that it was not just her, but her sister was involved as well. And so they both go to jail for murdering this man. It was inspiring to me because I was like, you know what? Sometimes I just take the surface answer and I'm happy with that. So in the months to follow, I just want you to know, I have solved the mystery of the missing sock. Guess what? It wasn't the dryer monster. There was actually a culprit in the missing sock case. I have solved the mystery of the missing chocolate at my house. And you might think, well, it was Eli or Emery. If you thought that, you'd be wrong. I have solved... I have solved the case of who knocked over my tackle box in the garage. Now, you may have come on the scene and seen a little girl's scooter right beside the tackle box and assumed surface level that Emery was the culprit, but guess what? It wasn't Emery. It was somebody else. I'm solving mysteries left and right. My family hates me now, but I don't care. I'm like, I'm going Matlock on this thing. So I applied the same philosophy to this scripture, because my whole life I was just like, well, Jesus was getting ready to die on the cross. So obviously that's what's got him all upset and breaking down in the garden, right? Well, let's look at some facts. Something came down on Jesus that utterly astonished and horrified him. But here's what I know about Jesus. Jesus did not receive new information about his future. Jesus knows everything that's going to happen before it happens. He's like, hey, the betrayer is here. It's time for me to go. He's telling them what's going to happen before it ever happens. And if you just go back in Matthew's gospel to chapter 16, verse 21, you read these words. It says, from then on, Jesus began to point out to his disciples that it was necessary for him to go to Jerusalem, suffer many things from the elders, chief priests, and scribes, be killed, and rise on the third day. He told his disciples exactly what was going to happen to him. He did not receive new information in the garden that caused him to be troubled. So why was he horrified and troubled and staggered before he ever got to the cross if he didn't receive any new information? Also notice that Jesus didn't show very much poise or peace. Poise and peace were Jesus' calling card. He faced situations that would have driven me crazy, where I would have had to attack or had to run, do something. I would have had to react. But Jesus always showed calm, cool, collected, peace, and poise. But in this moment, Jesus is anything but peaceful and anything but poised. So what came down on Jesus? Well, let's look at verse 39 for our answer. Going a little farther, he fell face down and prayed. And he said, my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will. Jesus keeps mentioning this cup. So I did some research on the cup, and it turns out that back before the cross was invented, way back in the day, they had a way of executing people that was horrific because they wanted to send a message to other would-be criminals that if you do this thing, this is what you have to look forward to. And they would execute people by making them drink a cup of poison. And that cup of poison began to be known in ancient times as the cup of wrath. And so the Hebrew prophets in the Old Testament, they used a common word from their vernacular when they were talking about God's justice towards sin, and they characterized this cup of wrath as symbolic to the sin of mankind. Isaiah chapter 51, verse 22 says, look, I have removed from your hand the cup that causes staggering, that goblet, the cup of my fury. You'll never drink it again. This is God talking through a prophet. He's saying, this cup is going to cause staggering. This cup is the cup of my fury. This cup is the justice of God against all of human sin and evil. But again, Jesus knew about this cup. He knew the Old Testament scriptures. This is not new information to him. He knew that he would have to drink the cup. So Jesus is in the garden, and something horrified him. Something staggered him. It was not new information, so what was it? This is what I believe happened. Jesus, in the garden, began to experience the justice of God before he ever got to the cross. He's getting a sneak peek of what the next day is going to be like. He's walking through the garden and he's experienced the wrath of God towards sinful humans. See, sin is simply giving the heart what it wants. Like when you decide that you want to be in charge of your schedule and that you want to be in charge of your time and your talent and your tithe and all those different things. When you're like, I don't want anything above me telling me what to do. I know about God, but I don't want to listen to God because I want to be the little g God of my own life. That is sin. And so God's justice is simply to give the heart what it wants. Our hearts desire to not have God, and so at the end of the day, God is like, okay, fine. You don't want me. You get exactly what you want. That's what justice is. You don't want to give. You don't want to tithe. You don't want to worship. You don't want to live by the moral code of Scripture. That's fine. That's your choice. You've been presented the gospel. You know that Jesus died and rose from the dead for you and your sin, but that's not enough for you. And so you decide that you want to be the God of your own life. You want to be in charge of all of these things. And so Jesus, God, just gives you what you want. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 9. They will pay the penalty of eternal destruction from the Lord's presence and from his glorious strength. The ultimate destruction is to be caught, to be severed or cut off from the love and the strength of God. See, we were made for the presence of God. We were created in his image. He built within us a desire in our heart to be connected to our Creator. And like flowers need sun, or Mario needs Luigi, like peanut butter needs banana. If you haven't tried it, try it, okay? Peanut butter, banana is really good, all right? These things need each other, and we need God in that same way. We are created to be in the presence of God. And so the worst thing that can ever happen to any of us is to be cut off from the presence of God. So what is Jesus doing as he's walking toward this place of prayer? I believe he's preparing his heart to go into prayer. I do that sometimes too. Before I pray, I just start meditating on God. And then when I get to prayer, I'm ready. You know, I'm ready to talk to him. And I believe this is what Jesus is doing. Is he drops off the disciples at the outer part of the garden. Then he says, you three, the inner circle guys, you come with me to the inner part of the garden. And as he's walking toward this inner part of the garden where he's going to kneel down and pray, he is starting to prepare his heart to communicate with his Father, as he has done countless times before. He was turning his soul to his Father, and for the first time in his life, he turned his soul to the Father, and there was nothing there but the abyss. That's what happened. It's not new information. It's the beginning of him drinking the cup of God's wrath. He's experiencing what we should have experienced. Bill Lane really helped me understand this. He says in his commentary, the dreadful sorrow and anxiety then out of which the prayer for the passing of the cup springs is not an expression of fear before a dark destiny, nor is it a shrinking from the prospect of physical suffering and death. It's neither of those things. It is rather the horror of the one who lives solely for the Father, who came to the Father before his betrayal and found hell rather than heaven open before him. Jesus turned to the Father, and there was nothing there but the abyss, the darkness of an infinite nothing. No God, no love, no strength, no light, just hell open before him. That's where the horror comes from. Jesus looked to his Father God for help. And instead of giving him help, his Father places before him the cup of wrath. Can you imagine? Can your mind go? He calls out to God for help, and God says, no, here's the cup of my wrath toward all of humanity's sin, past, present, and future. The cup that causes staggering, the goblet, the cup of God's fury. Jesus saw the cup in the garden, and he was staggered. So the reason people don't want to talk about this is because we want to just talk about God, and we want to talk about him as a God of love who just loves everybody. And that's true. He does love everybody. But if we leave out justice and we leave out the cup of God's wrath, then we are leaving behind the beauty of the gospel. Because without those things, God just loves you with a general type of love. It's like, yeah, I love Kevin. Yeah, I love Chap. Yeah. It's a general love. But that's not the love that God loves you with. God loves you with a costly love. Costly love is the greatest form of love that there is. And I refuse to minimize the amazing love of God by skipping over the garden and skipping all the way to the day where Jesus comes back from the dead. Because the garden begins the heart of the gospel. You have to grasp the garden in order to understand the cross and the resurrection. Jesus asked for another way, but there was no other way. The costly love of God was the only love that was capable of paying the price for my sin and for your sin. It could not be a general love. It had to be a costly love. Jesus was willing to drink the cup of God's wrath because he loved us and he loved his Father. But why? Why the sneak preview? Why did this happen in the garden and not on the cross? Well, Jonathan Edwards says that Jesus was brought to the abyss so that he could see where he was going. Jesus was brought to the edge of the abyss so that he could have a clear view of where he was going the next day when he died on the cross. Jesus needed to know what it was going to be like so he could knowingly, key word, so he could knowingly step into the abyss for us. It wouldn't have worked if he was just thrown up on the cross like, I'll figure it out when I get there, you know? He got a preview of what it was going to be like so he could knowingly. Nobody put Jesus on the cross. He says, I put myself on the cross. It was his choice, his decision. He allowed himself to go there. Knowingly, knowing exactly what it was going to be like when he went to that cross. Jonathan Edwards continues, and here's the beauty of the gospel. This is why we preach about these things. He says, when he took the cup then, knowing what was in it, so was his love to us infinitely more wonderful, and so was his obedience to God infinitely more perfect. Jesus did two things in the garden, two things connected to Matthew chapter 22, verse 37. Jesus said to them, love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your mind. This is the greatest and most important command. And the second one is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. Do you see what Jesus is doing here in the garden? He's keeping both of the greatest commandments. He is obeying God perfectly, and he is loving his neighbor perfectly. Jesus is going into the garden to die for Peter, James, and John. Right? You ever wonder why he took those three with him? He took them with him because they were going to fall asleep. Do you understand what happened here? Jesus is going into the garden to pray, and he's like, I've never asked anything of you disciples, but this is the time of my greatest need. I don't need you to do anything for me. I just need you to be there. I don't want to go through this moment alone. So you're my inner circle. You're my three most dependent people. So could you just come in the garden? Could you just pray? Could you just be there while I go through this? And three times, they fell asleep. God's like, that's the human race for you. Do you really want to drink the cup of wrath for these guys? You ask them to do one thing and they can't even do it. They're asleep while you need them to be awake. What a test, right? For anyone that says that Jesus did not know what he was getting ready to do the next day on the cross, they've never read about the garden. He knew full well who we are. Isn't this amazing, though? All of the Bible, you can read this thing cover to cover, and every single time God says, obey me, he says, it'll go well with you if you do. Every time. Obey me. I know what's best for you. I created you. I know where to put the fence to keep you from getting in trouble. I want you to live the abundant life. I love you. You're the crown jewel of my creation. I put myself into you. So do these things, and you will have the abundant life. But there's one time in Scripture, one time in the whole Bible, where it says, obey God, and you will be cast into the abyss. Obey God, and you will be separated from God. Obey God and you will experience hell instead of heaven. One time in the whole Bible, and it's right here, to his own son, Jesus. Think about it this way, parallel gardens. You have Adam in Genesis. He's in the garden and God says, obey me. Don't eat of the fruit of this tree over here. And you will live an abundant life, a perfect life, a sinless life in this garden forever and ever. Then he comes to his own son in a different garden. And he says, obey me, and you will be cast away from me. You see what's going on here? This sets up the most perfect act of obedience and love in history. Jesus was obedient, and he got nothing out of it. So, for example, if I go up to my kids and I give them a command, I say, hey, put your dishes in the dishwasher. And they're like, what will you give us? And then I say, like, a dollar. I don't know. That's no longer obedience. That's a bargain, isn't it? They're getting something in return for being obedient to me. That's not obedience. That's a bargain. And almost every act of love that you and I do for our neighbor and for God is done in the sense of a bargain, because most of us get something back. Even if it's just the joy of serving someone else, we receive something in return for our good works. But in this moment, Jesus was obedient and he got nothing out of it. This is real obedience. This is real love. This is when you do something for God and you get nothing in return. There's a story. It's not in the Bible, so don't be confused. Don't go looking for it. But I love the story. The disciples and Jesus are walking down the road, and Jesus says, hey, pick up a rock and carry it with you. And so all the disciples look on the ground. They find their rocks, and they start to carry. But Peter, you know, he's kind of a smart guy. He's like, eh. I don't want to carry a rock around. I don't know how long I'll have to carry this thing. So he searches around, and he finds the smallest little pebble that he can find on the side of the road. Being obedient, got my rock, but it's this big, right? So then they sit down to eat breakfast, and God says, take the rocks out. They take all their rocks out. God prays and turns all the rocks into, we'll just say, donuts, right? So everybody, all the Peter and James and John and all the other disciples, you know, they got these nice muffins and donuts, and they're so, and Peter's over there, and he's got a little mini muffin. Then Jesus is like, all right, pick up a rock. And so this time Peter's like, got this figured out. It'll be lunchtime soon. So he searches around. He finds the biggest rock that he can physically carry, throws that sucker on his shoulder, and he lugs it for mile after mile as they follow Jesus. And Jesus comes up to this beautiful lake, and he says, okay, guys, take out your rocks. They all take out their rocks. Peter's like, and he's like, throw them into the water. Peter's like, what? Wait a minute, Jesus. You're supposed to turn this thing into a birthday cake or something. Like, why are we getting rid of it now? And Jesus looks at Peter and he says, who were you carrying the rock for? Ouch. He wasn't carrying that rock because Jesus told him to. He's carrying the rock because he thinks it's going to get something out of it in the future. I'll obey you if I get this. It's a bargain. In this instance, for the first time in human history that I can find, Jesus perfectly carried the rock for us because he was getting nothing out of this. He obeyed God perfectly. It's costly love. It's the only love that can produce salvation. Tim Keller says, Jesus loved us for us because we fall asleep on him all the time. See, some people will tell you that Jesus went to the cross for the joy that was set before him. And I've even said this from the pulpit, that we are the joy that was set before him. Matlock, he wouldn't be satisfied with that one. He'd go an extra 20 minutes and figure out what was really set before Jesus. It wasn't just the joy of saving our souls. It was something even greater than that. It was the joy of being truly obedient to his Father, setting a perfect example for us. So let's close by asking one other question. What difference does this make to us? Well, Jesus put his sin into or we put our sin into Jesus' account, and Jesus put his righteousness into our account. Jesus got what we deserve, and we get what he deserves. What this means practically is that we are not living under the shame of a pardon. It's not just, I've been forgiven, and that's it. It's deeper than that. It's more than that. It's living a guilt-free, no condemnation, abundant life. It's not just, well, God forgave me of my sin. It's he forgave me of my sin, and he gave me Jesus' righteousness. Jesus lived the perfect life for us and then gave us that perfect life. When God looks at us, he sees perfection. He does not see our sin because our sin has been nailed to the cross. He sees his children. Perfectly loving children. So in essence, it boils down to this. God says, Jesus, this is what's ahead of you. These people that are asleep in the garden with you, these are the same people that you are getting ready to go to the cross for. And here's a sneak preview of what that's going to entail. Here's a look into the abyss. Here's the look into the horror. And God is like, Jesus, are you still willing to go through with it? And over and over and over again, what does Jesus say in the garden? Not my will, but yours be done. In other words, yes. Yes, I know they're going to fall asleep on me. I know they're sinners. I know they're going to let me down, but it doesn't matter because I want to be obedient to you and I want to show costly love to them because that's the only way that this gap is going to be bridged. So when you encounter that costly love, and that's the whole reason I've spent the last 30 minutes teaching you this scripture, because I want you to understand the costly love that Jesus has for you, because when you understand it, it radically empowers your life. How could I stand to be constantly disobedient to the Lord that gave his life for me in a costly way like that? How could I constantly stand to fall asleep on Jesus? How could I stand to keep chewing up all the good things in my life? I'm sorry, I keep comparing us to a dog, and that's really not my intention here. I'll find a better analogy next time I do this, but anyway. Why would I want to constantly keep disobeying my master? Why would I want to find ways to be away from him on Sundays instead of worshiping him? Why would I want to disobey him with my money and with my mouth and with the power that I've been given, the influence around me? Why would I want to continue to do these things when I look at the costly love of Jesus and what he did for me? You see, it's not about obeying out of human power. It's about understanding his love for us so that we can then fall in love with him because of his love for us. It's not a want to, he already did it, right? It's looking at what's already been done and just being madly in love with that. I stand amazed in the presence. Let's pray. Father, today we have taken a walk through the garden and we have seen the gospel in a way that I hope was extremely clear to all the different age groups represented in this room. And Lord, it is our prayer, our desire this morning that we draw near to you in a way where we just want to be obedient. And we know, Lord, that we're going to fall asleep on you. We know, Lord, that we're going to mess things up. We know, Lord, that we're going to get distracted and try to find 150 other things to do rather than worship you. We know that's who we are because we are sinners saved by grace. And I just want to thank you this morning that when you look into my heart, you don't see all the sin in my life, but Lord, you see the righteousness of your son Jesus who willingly stepped into the abyss. He went to hell for me. And Lord, spoiler alert, again, in a few weeks, we're going to talk about the resurrection and how you knocked down the gates of hell and how you took the keys with you. And Lord, how you loosed those that were in bondage to Satan and sin. And Lord, we're going to celebrate the fact that you weren't just a great teacher. You were God's son with the power to raise yourself from the dead, conquer our greatest enemies for us. And Lord, we know that you are alive right now, seated at the right hand of the Father, interceding in every single one of our lives. So we do celebrate that. But in this moment, for this sermon, Lord, we are just taken by the costly love that you have showed us on Calvary's cross. And I pray that that love will propel us into a deeper relationship with you. And for some that are listening right now, you might say, well, I don't know how to have that relationship. I don't know how to move into a real relationship with Jesus. How? Well, the Bible says in Romans 10:9 that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. So the simple prayer this morning is just to say, God, I know I'm a sinner. I need a Savior. And I believe that's Jesus. Forgive me. I believe he died on the cross. I believe he rose from the dead. So I just give my life to him. And I don't even know what that means all the way. Lord, that's all you require of us. Thank you for doing the heavy lifting. Thank you for doing all the work. And for those of us that are Christians, Lord, and maybe we become distracted by all the different things that this world throws our way, Lord, I pray that today would be a day where we remember that the greatest thing that was ever done for us, the greatest love that was ever shown to us, was not from our mom or our dad or our spouse or our kids. The greatest love that we've ever received was the costly love of Jesus Christ. And as we view his love, I pray that it propels us, Lord, to want to be the people that you've created us to be, so that, Lord, we can show others the good news of Jesus Christ. Father, this morning I just stand amazed in your presence. I don't understand why you did what you did for sinful old me, but Lord, wow, thank you for it. So as we sing praises to him in closing today, I pray that we would sing from our hearts and not just our mouths. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Stand with us, please. Amazed in the presence of